today I am going to discuss on a topic of antidiabetic drugs other than insulin. Antidiabetic drugs are of different categories, and these are used as a first-line agents in type 2 diabetes patients. Insulin is used exogenously in the patients who are unable to produce their insulin on their own. Which is the final stage of treatment. So before going into the antidiabetic drugs, I will just briefly describe on what diabetes is. Diabetes is a condition in which there is a persistent hyperglycemia condition in the blood. That is the high blood sugar levels, which make the person feel tiredness, having their mouth dried, feeling thirsty, drowsiness, and polyuria. Because there is high blood sugar levels in the blood, this becomes the person feels sluggish also, because high blood sugar levels will make the oxygenation doesn't take it properly, because the blood flow also gets disturbed properly, so that makes you feel laziness and feeling almost exhausted all the time. He feels very tired because of no proper oxygen supply to the cells. So there are type 2 diabetes conditions are of two types: type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes. Type 1 diabetes is seen in the children mostly. It occurs in the early stages of life, where it is an autoimmune disorder in which the pancreas is destructed on its own. So the pancreas is unable to produce its insulin, so the person has to depend on the exogenous insulin. Type 2 diabetes is mostly seen in the patients. About 85% of the people in the world suffer from type 2 diabetes, in which the patient has having a pancreas and they have the insulin also producing from the pancreas, but there is no sufficient insulin which meets the requirements of the glucose. There is high glucose levels in the blood, but there is less insulin. That makes the person hyperglycemia. In type 2 diabetes patients, we see the insulin resistance happening. Insulin resistance, this is just a clear idea on what healthy living style of the person would be having and how the insulin resistance is happening here in the patient. Generally, in the normal state of the humans, the blood glucose passes in the stream and it should pass into the cell. So when the glucose should pass into the cell, insulin should be required to be binding to the insulin receptor, so that it opens the glucose transporters where the glucose enters into the cell. But here in the insulin resistance, as insulin is getting resisted to the binding to its receptor, glucose is unable to enter into the cell, so there is persistent increase in the glucose levels in the blood. So this binding, though there is insulin, it is unable to bind to the receptor. So this is called insulin resistance. This may be due to the structural malformations in the insulin or its receptor, so that it is unable to bind properly to each other. So this is called insulin resistance. So in the diabetes patients, we need to make sure that their insulin gets secreted, and how their insulin should be acted so that it improves to make the glucose transported into the cell. And there are drugs which slow down the rate of carbohydrate digestion, which some drugs are there which increase the incretin effect. Some of the glucagons suppress the glucagon secretion, and which are there some of the drugs which will slow the gastric emptying. So these are the classification, and I will go one by one briefly on what these drugs act, how they act on. Firstly, I'm going to the sulfonylureas. and prandial insulin releases. How do they act? Sulfonyl ureas are very common ones, and these are very important drugs which are used in type 2 diabetes patients. So these sulfonyl ureas, they act on the sulfonyl urea receptor on the plasma membrane in the cytosolic phase of the receptor. So these sulfonyl ureas go into the cytosolic phase of and bind to the sulfonyl urea receptor, and this receptor binding will make the potassium channel, which is adjacent to it, called K6.2. This channel gets closed. So when this channel gets closed, there is no efflux of potassium ion to the outside of the cell. So this positivity here in the inside of the cytoplasm will make the local depolarization of the cell membrane, which leads to the activation of the voltage-gated calcium channels. As this is voltage-dependent calcium channels, so here when the depolarization takes place, these voltage-gated calcium channels gets opened, calcium ions enter into the cell. When they enter into the cell, these calcium ions, they trigger the release of insulin from the granules, insulin granules, through the exocytosis. So the firstly, when the insulin, the ones which are on the granules which are on the outer, which are near to the plasma membrane, are released first, which is a part of a first phase insulin release. So talking on about the sulfonyl urea receptor here, this is sulfonyl urea receptor, which is a octamer, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So this is receptor, and the one which is present inside is a potassium channel, having four potassium channels and four receptors. So this is an octamer. Each SUR1 is having a channel, a potassium channel like this. So each SUR1 has a 17 membrane transmembrane helix. See, if you count this one, these are of 17, and they have two nucleotide binding sites, and this potassium channel on the cytosolic phase, they have the ATP binding site. So any sulfonyl urea binds to the SUR1, they activate the potassium channel, they block the potassium channel flux, potassium ions flux from through the potassium channel through this pore. So this is about the sulfonyl urea receptor. The sulfonyl ureas, they also act, they increase the insulin release through this pathway. So it is not dependent upon the glucose metabolism, glucose concentrations. So there is always a risk of hypoglycemia when sulfonyl urea is given. And they also have an extra pancreatic effects by suppressing the kinase which leads to the formation of fructose 2,6 bisphosphate. So when this fructose 2,6 bisphosphate is present, this would stimulate the phosphofructokinase, which leads to the formation of fructose 1,6 bisphosphate, and suppresses the fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase. So it would suppress the gluconeogenesis pathway. So it reduces the glucose levels through gluconeogenesis, inhibits the gluconeogenesis pathway, and thereby improving the glycolytic flux. So it would lead to the, it would help in the glycolysis, but suppresses the gluconeogenesis. In this way, it also acts in reducing the glucose levels in the blood. In the same way, prandial insulin releases like rapaglutinide, natriglutinide, they also bind to the same kind of they do have a same kind of mechanism like this, how sulfonyl urea is having. but they bind to the sulfonylurea receptor onto the other site adjacent to the same site located for the sulfonylurea, but on the different place, and acts in the same way how this sulfonylurea is acting. And biguanides are very famous, like metformin is a very famous drug which has been there since 1950s. This is a first line drug for all the diabetes patients. The mechanism of action is not clearly understood, but it helps the patient in many ways in decreasing the gluconeogenesis, suppressing gluconeogenesis, and decreasing glycogenolysis and reducing the fatty acid oxidation. It improves the insulin action by glucose uptake. It also transports the GLUT4 transporters onto the plasma membrane, so that glucose is transported into the cell. It improves the glycogenesis and decreases the fatty acid oxidation in the muscle also. So metformin helps in many ways in reducing the blood glucose concentrations. The third class is thiazolidinediones. These drugs act on the PPAR gamma, peroxisome proliferator activated receptor gamma, which is a nuclear receptor. So when actually this one binds with the retinoid X receptor, which is a heterodimer. When these act on the PPRE, peroxisome proliferator response element, on the promoter region. So whenever this ligand binds to the PPAR gamma and binds to PPRE, automatically co-repressors gets dissociated and co-activators bind to the PPAR gamma and help in the transcription, gene transcription, and then help in the fatty acid uptake and lipogenesis and adipocyte differentiation. So the ligand binds to PPAR gamma, like ligands like pioglitazone, rosiglitazone, and many other drugs. These bind to the PPAR gamma, and simultaneously cis-retinoic acid binds to the RXR moiety. They both bind to the PPRE and then leads to the transcription and helps it in the glucose uptake by increasing the transporter, glucose transport, GLUT4 transporters to the plasma membrane, and also increases the fatty acid uptake. These are some of the expression patterns of these, these PPAR gamma receptors are all present mainly in the white and brown adipose tissue, and these are weakly expressed in liver, muscle, gut, and pancreatic beta cells. The natural ligands are unsaturated fatty acids and prostaglandin metabolites. Synthetic ligands like rosiglitazone, pioglitazone, these drugs, and some of the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. These are the genes activated, and the biological actions are adipocyte differentiation and fatty acid uptake. So this helps in the reduction of the free fatty acid levels in the blood, so that the glucose gets utilized instead of taking the energy source from the fatty acids. So improving the glucose utility by the body, and helps in the formation of lipids from the subcutaneous deposit into the adipocytes. This all happens in the nucleus. And the other class of drugs are alpha glucosidase inhibitors. The alpha glucosidase inhibitors are used to reduce the carbohydrate digestion. Alpha glucosidase enzymes are present on the brush border of the intestinal walls of the enterocytes. The alpha glucosidases are of different types, like maltase, dextrinase, glucoamylase. So there are many enzymes like that which will help in the cleavage of disaccharides and oligosaccharides into the monosaccharides, which are absorbable into the intestine, into the finally into the bloodstream. So these alpha glucosidase inhibitors, they competitively bind to the alpha glucosidase enzymes and inhibit the and decrease the reduce the alpha glucosidase action. The examples like acarbose, meglitol, and voglibose. Acarbose binds competitively, and these drugs have different binding affinities. These acarbose would bind more effectively on the glycoamylase, but meglitol binds more on the sucrase. So it binds, affinity would differ between these inhibitors. But the main action is to reduce the intestinal carbohydrate digestion, and thereby reducing the glucose levels in the bloodstream. So whenever the patient has a blood carbohydrate-rich meal, their hyperglycemia is not seen in the patients after the meal. So it will help in the reduction of the glucose levels after the meals. Some of the drugs like incretin mimetics and gliptins are used. Incretin mimetics, incretin is a kind of hormone which is released from the intestines, which helps in maintaining the satiety. There are two kinds of hormones like GIP and GLP-1. GIP is glucose independent insulin tropic polypeptide, and GLP-1 glucagon like polypeptide 1. So GIP is glucagon like insulin tropic polypeptide. So this GLP-1 acts in, this GIP is produced from the K cells of the duodenum and ileum, and GLP-1 is released from the L cells of the ileum. It helps in the satiety, and whenever there is a glucose mediated, when there is a glucose meal in the intestine, this would activate these hormones and thereby increase the insulin levels through this pathway, through this GLP-1. So the drugs like exenatide is a GLP-1 analog. This exenatide has a has a 52% sequence homology with the human GIPs, and acts like the how GLP-1 acts, thereby increasing the insulin levels. GLP-1 is the pure GLP-1, human GIP or GLP-1 is not given to the humans because they have a very short half-life, because they are cleaved by the dipeptidyl peptidase 4 enzyme, so that its half-life is less than 2 minutes. The exenatide is the similar kind of GLP-1 analog, which is different from these GLP-1s in just a sequence. Like alanine is absent here, alanine is present here, but here it is replaced with glycine. Dipeptidyl peptidase binds, it cleaves at the N-terminus region wherever the alanine or prolyline residues are there. So exenatide would helps in this avoiding this cleavage from by DPP4, and its action is, its biological half-life is 5 to 7 hours. And generally it is given from through the subcutaneous route. Gliptins like sitagliptin, and there are also natural gliptins like neuropeptide Y, peptide YY, gastrin releasing polypeptide, insulin like growth factor 1, and these are all there in which they generally bind to these DPP4, inactivate these DPP4 dipeptidase. And increase the insulin levels, just like how this exenatide would do. So that they maintain the incretin levels. They increase the incretin levels, and thereby induces the insulin secretion. And exenatide is actually found in the saliva of Gila monster. This is a lizard. It is first found on the saliva of the Gila monster. Pramlintide is another class of compound and is another class of drug, antidiabetic drug, which is actually before going into the it's a kind of IAPP analog, amylin analog. Intestinal amyloid polypeptide. Generally, before in the type 2 diabetes patients, people use it to believe that type 2 diabetes is happening because of the amylin deposition. Because it in the pancreas, we find the accumulation and aggregation of these amylin deposits in the pancreas of the type 2 diabetes patients. So people believe that it might be the cause of the type 2 diabetes. But amylin helps in the glucose homeostasis. It binds to the it acts centrally in the central nervous system and near the area postrema, which is actually where the blood-brain barrier is absent. And it acts in this centrally, and in turn this would vagally stimulate in reducing the suppression of glucagon secretion and reducing the hepatic glucose output, and also reduces the gastric emptying, slows down the gastric emptying, thereby finally leading to the decrease in the glucose levels. Amylin helps in satiety, so making the person eat less, and finally we can see there is a decrease in the obesity. The amylin is a peptide like this, and pramlintide is a synthetic peptide just very similar to the amylin, but only in that it is replaced in three places here with proline residues. So this is pramlintide, and this drug is actually, pramlintide is given along with the, it is actually used in adjunct to the insulin therapy. It is usually given before the meals so that the patient would have the meals in with reduced carbohydrate meal. It helps in the taking less food. So these are all the different kinds of drugs, of the antidiabetic drugs. Generally in diabetes patients, in type 2 diabetes, the patient is suspected to have the pancreas unable to produce enough insulin. The first line of therapy is metformin. Metformin is given to the patient, and the patient may improve his glucose levels in the blood by improving the insulin sensitivity. And sometimes sulfonylureas are also given to the patients to improve the insulin action. But all these drugs should be, it can be given to the patients when the pancreas is able to at least produce enough insulin, so that we can improve the insulin levels, increase the insulin levels from the pancreas. Alpha glucosidase inhibitors are also given to the patients whom they are having high glucose levels after the meals, postprandial hypoglycemia. So in that such kind of conditions, these drugs are given. And finally, when the patient is taking two or three kinds of classification of drugs and is still unable to maintain the glucose levels in the blood, then the patient would be taken into the exogenous insulin therapy. In this way, the antidiabetic drugs are classified and how it should be given to the patient. Thank you for watching, and please don't forget to subscribe.